All right, welcome to the Warm Chord Music Podcast. This is Jay Croft, and I've got Ryan Looney from Electric Alley. Is it audio or music?
Music, right now.
Right now. For now.
Yes, for now.
Okay, so last episode we did, we talked about Pantera. So I want to thank all you folks out there for checking that out. It was a fun episode. Went a lot longer than we anticipated. But, you know, some brewskis had to blame for that one.
Yes, sir.
So just a warning, if you're going to do a podcast, it might not be a good idea to drink too hearted and then double IPAs before it. you might have a very long episode. But it was fun nonetheless. We got a lot of good feedback on it. And
yes, it was.
We actually reached out to you guys on Facebook just a couple days ago about this episode we're about to do now, which is on our favorite drum recordings. So
yeah,
we're gonna read some of those comments, give some shout outs to you guys for supporting the podcast and you know, just engaging a little bit with us, because I think that makes it fun, is to pull some different opinions into this. So what we're gonna do today is talk about our favorite drum recordings. We both put together a top 10, not in any particular order. And we have a lot of, you know, different albums we'll talk about, and maybe some specific drum performances or songs, you know, just in general, things that we've dug over the years growing up listening to different drummers play and what's influenced us. So Ryan, why don't you kind of give folks an idea of how you came up with your top 10. What are some of the things that you were thinking about when you put it together?
Okay, well, when I put together the top 10, I didn't really think about... I tried to take, like, my engineering brain out of it, if you will. And I just kind of tried to put together, like, a top 10 list of, like, what songs evoked an emotion out of me. So, I went from everything from when we were kids, you know, back in high school, to nowadays, where, you know, it's just like, I didn't really put the recording process into it. I just said, like, this is cool to me. You know, this sounds good to me for whatever reason. Then I kind of went back and I analyzed and I said, you know, cause I spent a little time on this, and I said, like, why would this make my top 10, you know? And I kind of listened. I said, oh, you know, that snare crack or whatever, you know, whatever it was. So
did you do this by album or song?
I did by song.
Okay. See, I did it by album.
But that's okay, because
so you got something different.
Most of the songs that I did, the tone encompasses the whole record.
Right.
I thought about that too. I was like, oh shit, like, am I doing the wrong, you know? So
no, it's cool, because on Facebook people mostly gave songs, right? And even some individual drummers.
Yeah.
Some people did albums. I did it by album. So just kind of a different angle.
Yeah. But nonetheless, like, kind of like all my songs that I picked, the whole album, as you know, like some albums, like drum tone changes from song to song. Most of my songs, like, for whatever reason, this band chose to go with the same tone the whole time. So you could swap it out for album or whatever. And I listed album, and then I listed song on my notes. So
yeah, I think with the album, for me, was tough. What made it tough was I could have very easily selected a song, but then I was looking at, as a whole, the whole album.
Yeah.
Was there just one song that stuck out to me, and the rest was, like, cool but not as much stand out, or the whole album as a whole, you know? So I kind of looked at it a little bit different way. So, I mean, that's
kind of cool. Yeah, it's cool.
Why don't we get started? Because I didn't really do it much differently than you did. I didn't take my engineering hat off.
Okay.
I thought about the performance, the groove, the the actual sound. Like, because as a drummer, I think you probably agree, you know, certain sounds inspire you just as much as, you know, how crazy something can be drum, you know, performance wise. So I did definitely consider drum sound in there too.
Okay. So I guess, like, I shouldn't say I completely, abandoned the engineering hat, but I tried my best to just go like, okay, like, what about this album, like, resonates with me? What sings in me, you know? And then if it was like some kind of reverb or compression or whatever on there, then that's cool. Like, I took note of that in my notes, but at the same time, I'm just thinking like, okay, this really stands out to me as like a good drum performance. At, you know, like, I'm trying to think of like being a person like kind of on the outside, like Billy Corgan like put it, in an interview I watched with him and Lars.
Oh, we were just talking about the Lars.
Yeah. So he said like something about like, to most people, like music is magic to them, you know? So I try to kind of like put myself into the shoes of like an everyday person saying like, I don't know what a drum is. I don't know what a snare drum is. I don't know what any recording, you know? So I try to put myself into those shoes when I did my top 10 list.
Well, Corgan said something else in that interview that I'm definitely going to reference that I think will be...
Okay.
That makes sense. So why don't we do this? So let's kind of trade back and forth for our top 10. So why don't you go first? What do you got?
Okay. No particular order or anything, right?
Yeah.
No. Okay. Yeah. So the first thing that came onto my radar... was Rage Against the Machine's Evil Empire album.
That's a good one.
And People of the Sun, the first track, really stuck out to me for whatever reason. I noted on here just like it was kind of weird because the track is really heavy, but when you listen to it, the snare is very like warm and very just like kind of subdued on the track. It still has a pop to it and everything, but it's somewhat a little bit like more warmer than you'd think like for a track like that. So
yeah. No, that's a good one, man. So what made you choose that over the first Rage? Because I've heard people dig both of those albums, obviously. So which would you like about the drums on that one versus was it self-titled? The first Rage album?
Rage was self-titled. Yeah. Okay. The first one, the black and white cover with the monk putting himself on fire or whatever. So I love the openness of it, man. It was kind of like reminiscent of a John Bonham. It was very like ringy snare for that particular era.
Open.
You know, like, I mean, if you think about like, what was that, 94? 93, somewhere around there? 94? Like, everything was really tight then. You know, you had Korn coming out with a really, you know, compressed, really simple snare drum, no overtone. And if you listen to People of the Sun, especially, it's really open drums, man. It's very John Bonham, you know, esque. So that's why I chose that. I thought it was just a really cool groove. You could tell it was recorded to tape. Just really cool.
That's great, man. That's a great pick.
Thank you.
Well, because you mentioned Korn, I'm going to go ahead and one of the shout outs actually is to John O'Hare, a friend of mine. You know John?
I don't know if I know John. Okay.
So John mentioned the first Korn record as something that he really dug drum wise, and I didn't have that on my list or anything, but I respect that pick because I remember when we were younger when Korn came out. It was very different. There really was anything like it.
Yeah.
And he definitely has some chops. I can't remember what his name is. It escapes me.
David Silvera?
That sounds familiar.
Something. David something. Silvera.
Yeah. So that's shout out to John. So thanks, John, for...
Thank you, John.
...for bringing that up.
Yeah, I love the first two Korn records.
Yeah.
Like, I think like that... I don't know what was going on with the kick drum versus the bass guitar, but there was some kind of weird attack shit going on.
No, it's different. It stands out.
Yes. Okay, why don't we bounce back to you? And so, I want to hear about your...
I'm gonna bring up Bad Motorfinger from Soundgarden.
Oh God, yes.
So okay. Matt Cameron. So Matt Cameron is kind of subdued at times. I think especially now that he's with Pearl Jam, you don't really hear him doing a lot of crazy stuff. But although Super Unknown is probably my favorite record, just because of the songs are so good. Bad Motorfinger as a drummer. You know, I would say that he's probably one of the only drummers of that era that rivals Jimmy Chamberlain in his use of the hi-hat.
Yep.
And in that record, if you listen to just trying to figure out, like, how to play Soundgarden songs, like, the way that he plays odd time signatures is so smooth and in the pocket, sometimes you don't even realize. He makes it sound easier than it is to play his parts. And if you listen to Jesus Christ Pose, that's probably the one song I would say is the standout for me on that track. The heavy use of the toms definitely influenced me as a drummer. And then while he's doing the, you know, he's doing open hi-hat stuff here and there, you know. So that one was... I kept thinking, is it really one of my favorites? But then I kept going back to, as a kid, and even to this day, what he does on that record as a whole just impresses me. So that was my number. That was my first one, I guess.
I will say, like, Matt Cameron, man, as he's, like you said, it's very covert in his technicality, you know, but then you start listening to it and you're like, holy hell, like what is going on here? You
know? I'm gonna throw a Detroit reference in here.
Okay,
so I kind of think of him as like the Nick Lidstrom of drumming.
Yes.
Okay,
that's a great way to put it.
Yeah, he's like that ultra consistent, you know, dude that just can play. Have you ever tried playing Outshined on drums before?
No, but I love that song.
Try playing it when you play the slow, when it, you know, it's got that slower, sludgier feel.
Yeah.
There's a lot of open space in between some of those hits, and just challenge yourself to not put a bunch of stuff in there.
Right.
Because that's a tough pocket to play to.
I can imagine you'll fall off time pretty quickly.
Yeah, so that's one of those things where it's a little bit trickier than you think. So
yeah, I love that though. Matt Cameron, yeah. He should have been on my list for sure. Plus just Soundgarden, you know, like, yeah. I mean,
we're
everything.
We're both gonna have
everything
ones that didn't make our list, so that's,
yeah,
that's good. What
everything they've done, like, I can't think of like anything where I've heard from Soundgarden where I'm like, wow, that's not like a really creative way to stage that part, you know, like, I would say you'd play more like Matt Cameron than I would, probably. Like, I feel like you have more of his groove down. But God, yeah, great pick, dude. Great.
What do you
pick.
Got? What's number nine? Number nine.
Number nine or number two?
Well,
or
whatever.
However,
way
you look
at it. So, do you have a number one? Like,
no,
like,
I really don't. I didn't list any numbers, so I just kind of went through like some stuff.
Okay.
So,
all right.
Is
what's
that
your
cool?
next one?
Okay, so next I'm gonna go. I'm trying to keep things like somewhat commercial here, so I'm gonna go with Rush, Tom Sawyer.
So, Tom Sawyer, Moving Pictures.
Yes.
Man, I had a hard time.
I
got Rush too. I've got Rush too.
Okay.
But I got a different album from you, and Moving Pictures, that it was like that between that and another record, it kept going back and forth.
Cool.
So what do you got about Tom Sawyer?
Okay, so like I just love the kind of the machine like drum work on that. Just very, if you're not a drummer, it grooves. If you're a drummer, you go, wow, man, that guy's really, you know, he's really doing some cool stuff. The ride cymbal pattern, and, you know, we all know how that is on that song as a drummer. But outside, I feel like anyone that's listening to that song goes, can, like, zone in on the drums and go, wow, like, something special about that, right? Like, they might not know what the hell Neil Peart is doing.
But is it Peart or Peart?
I don't know.
What are we going to... I can't do Peart, I'm sorry.
Neil Peart. But whatever Neil Peart is doing during that 7 minutes or whatever the song is, probably not that long. But it's like, it's just really in the pocket, it's grooving. And then as a drummer, when you can analyze it, it's like, then you really realize, like, wow, like, this guy has some chops. And it completely molds to the track around it. Awesome track.
There's actually a software program, I forget the name of it, I had it for a while. You can download it for your phone or for your iPad, and it allows you to download all these different band songs, and it they got the licensing for it, and they actually got the track, so they can take out the drums. Oh. And they'll play all the instruments with the click in the background, so you can play along to Rush without Neil Peart in the track.
That's awesome.
So go ahead, if you're a drummer, and I'll see if I can look it up at some point in the episode here, what it's called, but go ahead, play that as a drummer without Neil Peart behind you.
Yeah.
And see how you do.
But you know what?
Because it's a tricky song to play.
Well, the funny thing is, like, you know, I've never learned a Rush song, and I think that's, like, something you should do. It's like a rite of passage or something. And I never have done that.
No.
You know, so I feel like before I'm too old to pull it off, I should learn, like, front to back, Rush, something, Tom Sawyer, whatever, you know, and, like, do it the right way. At the same time, I feel like maybe I can reinvent Tom Sawyer. So
there you go, man.
Yeah.
All right. Well, I'll go ahead with my
Rush. Okay, yep. I want to hear your nine or two.
So it's not, it's mixed in there, but since you brought up Rush, I'm going to go ahead and bring up my Rush.
Yes, sir.
Permanent Waves.
Okay.
Mostly because of Free Will and Spirit Radio. To this day, when I
Free Will is great.
Yeah. Well, and shout out to another person on Facebook. So Randall Clayton.
Okay.
He wanted to bring up Free Will, which I can't.
That song jams.
Man. Yeah, man. Well, when they get out of that break or that
shout out to Randy.
Yeah, when they get into the stuff in the middle there, like it's. So the bass and the drums are doing their own thing compared to Lifeson. He's kind of doing his solo, and it's like it's almost like they're playing two different songs at times, and they all come together. And then Spirit of Radio, the beginning. Like, it's so all over the place. It's almost like Morse code.
Yeah.
And I still, to this day, I haven't actually sat down to figure it out, but I still... Every time I hear it, I still appreciate how crazy that intro is because I can never figure it out.
Still,
like,
right?
Yeah, like, I'm like, I don't know what they're doing. I just give up. Like, I can't... I'll get through, like, the first couple lines where I think I know what's going on, and I'm not counting it out or anything. I've never looked it up.
Yeah.
But it's so amazing to me when you watch those guys play it live. But to them, it's like nothing. It's like a song that you I play every day, and we never think about it.
Sure. Like 4-4, four on the floor, whatever.
The whole album, though, is great. Jacob's Ladder, there's, like, awesome drumming going on there. Natural Science, there's some crazy drum fills going in that song. So that song to me is just, or that album to me is just song after song after song of creative, appropriate, tasteful drumming. It sounds great. The album sounds great to this day. It holds up. I think it was recorded. When was it? Was that before Moving Pictures?
Not sure the year of that, but
it might have been after. Actually, I think it was after. But
it sounded a little.
Yeah.
A little crisper, right?
Well,
newer.
Yeah. Forgive me. I should know this. I should know what.
Damn it, Quill.
I know exactly. For being a big Rush fan.
You don't know the year.
On the spot, I can't remember. But it's a great album. So for me, Permanent Waves.
So, just let's go off on a tangent for a second, because I know these things can get very long.
But to our defense this time, we don't have the Machu Picchu.
Yes, we don't have the 11%, 0.18.
So instead of 2.5 hours, this episode might be 2 hours.
2 hours, yeah. We win. But, you know, like, as a fan of drums, as a fan of, like, the prog rock, as you could say, you know, like, I just feel like Neil Peart is, like, just, like, so much more than, to me, as a musician, like, I look into, like, his life, you know, and I'm like, wow, like, this guy's gone through a lot of stuff. Didn't his wife die or kid and his die daughter. Or something? His wife and his kid, right? Yeah. And then he took, like, a motorcycle journey for a year or something and completely put the band on hold. And, like, man, this guy's experienced crazy shit. And then he reinvented his technique, right? Didn't he go, traditional. Like, and went traditional grip, right?
Yeah,
which,
yeah.
If you don't know as a listener what traditional grip is, that's when you basically, like, flip the stick over into your hand and play like you're in the Civil War. Left-handed.
Yeah.
So, I just think that's crazy. Like, he wanted to learn, like, what it was like to go back to that, like, more natural, you know, jazz era, whatever you want to call it, you know.
Well, he even said in his video that they did a while ago, one of the documentaries, when he did that whole situation where he went and kind of relearned things and changed his style, Geddy Lee was saying, you know, to us, you know, it doesn't really sound, he didn't really sound any different.
Yeah.
But it probably felt a little different.
Yeah.
To Neil, though, it was a different feel. You know, he had to keep challenging himself. So, yeah, tons of respect to him for doing that. And
totally, yeah.
Permanent Waves actually came out the year before Moving Pictures, so just to clarify that.
Okay.
So it looks like 1980 for Moving Pictures, for Permanent Waves, 81 for Moving Pictures. Man, that's
a tight
time
frame, two albums.
And back then, that's what was happening, you know?
Yeah.
I mean, that's about bands put stuff together or put stuff out a lot more frequently.
Yeah.
So, but two albums back to back like that, just two badass albums
and
Hemispheres before that.
Yeah.
You know?
They had it all, man. You got to give it up to Rush, yeah, man.
I think if we didn't have at least one Rush record in this top 10, we probably would have. People would have unsubscribed.
Yeah. Hey, unsubscribe now if there is not a Rush. No.
Right.
So subscribe now, right?
Exactly. So yes. What do you got? What's number three? Or
okay, so I will. I'll kind of keep with the 70s, 80s theme. I think this was early 70s, but Black Sabbath.
Which one?
I put Black Sabbath, Black Sabbath.
Okay.
Specifically the song Behind the Wall of Sleep. I just thought that song was like everything heavy metal that was never before it. So.
Bill Ward, man.
Bill Ward, dude. I mean, a monster.
Yeah, I had Masters of Reality as an honorable mention.
Oh, right. Yeah. What was this? Sweet Leaf? Oh, shit.
That drum. Exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah. I was listening to some Sabbath the other day because I actually finally got Paranoid on vinyl. You know, I was listening to that because I love that record. But then I was, you know, I don't remember really listening to a lot of other Sabbath records, because as a kid, I always had Paranoid, and that was it. So I went and I was looking up Masters of Reality, because I kept hearing people talk about how great it was. And I was like, well, I know Sweet Leaf, you know, I've heard this song. But I must not have listened to it that closely when I was younger, because I didn't remember Bill Ward doing, like, some sick drum licks in that song. So, Bill Ward was pretty damn good,
pretty cool. Like, he was, I felt like he was just like unhinged, you know, just like, it was very like, very like stream of conscious, very just like whatever came out, you know, was on the record. And for back then, I mean, that was like kind of, you know, you had the Beatles, you know, like kind of overlapping
yeah.
what they were doing at that time. That was like true metal at that time, you know? So you had twin guitars, you had like Ozzy, like doubling vocals at the time, you know, which was kind of unheard of in that era. And then you had like Bill Ward, like throwing down, like, I don't know how those cymbal stands lasted through him. I mean, you know, you could say like John Bonham is like the king of like hitting hard, but I thought Bill Ward, man, very underrated drummer. So
that's a good one.
And you?
All right. So I'm going to bring things more current.
I like it.
So 2006, there was Ooh. This band that I heard about for the first time and didn't know anything about them until my friend.
Nickelback?
Yeah.
Yes. Now, I love that.
My
choice.
Friend Jason Bate introduced me to Mastodon.
Okay.
And right. I heard Blood Mountain for the first time and was blown away. Like, I.
Okay.
The Wolf is Loose, I think, is the first track. There's some unbelievable songs on that record. But the drumming, to me, was like, I have not heard anybody play drums like this in a long time, like current drummers. There's a lot of metal drummers that are just unbelievable with their feet. Mm. But this guy, like, can do everything with his hands that some of those amazing 60s and 70s drummers could do. Like, wow. I almost think of, like, Mitch Mitchell from Hendrix. Okay. You know, the guy, like, yeah. just has unbelievable, to me, the guy's got some great chops, but he uses them in a pretty, you know, creative way. And Mastodon is kind of like a prog metal band, you know. So there is a lot more opportunity for him to do that. But he's one of the few metal drummers out there that I've heard in the last, you know, 15 years or so, who's actually making more use of the hands than the feet.
So what kind of things is he doing with his hands? Like, just, like, pattern-wise?
Yeah,
is
it like... it's really a lot of his snare-to-tom work. A lot of the snare-to-tom okay. runs and stuff. A lot of use of accenting, so it's not just straight 16ths. You know, or triplets all across the kit. It's he actually has like some of what Lombardo has. Okay. You know, when Lombardo does a lot of the snare to tom fills, he really, you know, makes good use of accenting. You know, yeah. So it's not just he really has a lot of fluidity in his playing.
Gotcha.
So I'm not like the world's biggest Mastodon fan, but that record to me just stands out. Like, if I want to hear something in the last, you know, 10 to 12 years that just blows my mind as a drummer, it's like, man, that's not, I don't really know if it's triggered or not, if there's samples going on. It sounds like a very natural drum sound to me. But the dude just slays on that record.
So I haven't really heard much of Mastodon. I know Scott Anger is a big fan of Mastodon from way back when. And I never could get really into him, you know. I don't know why. But I will definitely revisit.
Yeah, that Brand record. Daler is the name of the drummer.
Okay.
He's got some sick skills, man. Cool. So check it out.
Yeah, I love the feet thing, but I also love, like, as you said, like, accompanying the, you know, everything.
If you listen to him play, you'll appreciate, like, how much of the stuff he does is the same things that you appreciate about Neil Peart and Chamberlain okay. and those guys. Like, yeah. he's got a lot of that upper body... those chops, man. Where it's just, and nothing again. You know, I love, you know, like Adler from Lamb of God, for example.
Yeah, yeah. He's but, very feet
yeah,
oriented.
Yeah, though. Where yeah. it's almost the opposite with Brand okay. Daler. So,
yeah, I feel like Chris. Is that Chris?
Yeah.
Chris Adler. Yeah, he's not on my list, but, you know, he's very technical on the feet and very simplistic on the hands. And,
yeah.
You know, it works for what he does, but, yeah.
Cool.
Okay, cool.
What's Let's next move on yours?
Okay, is it my turn?
It is.
Okay. So, next on my list, I have... actually, what might segue into our next podcast really well is The Dead Weather. And it is called Hang You From the Heavens is the song. And Whorehound is the album. So this is Jack White drumming.
Oh, okay. So I was just going to ask you who was the actual drummer on that one.
Yep. So this is Jack White drumming. His hi-hat groove, excuse my singing skills, but it's like a... Psst, that's the main riff through the whole thing, like bzz, bzz, God, bzz, bzz. And how they recorded it was very Zeppelin-y, you know, just like really open, really roomy, ringy snare, nothing's pretty about it. And reason why I chose this was because you have a guitarist in a sense playing the drums, you know, which is, I thought, like a different take on, like, you know, you or I playing, or someone that's schooled in this, you know, field. You have someone on the outside just kind of like raw and laying down what needs to be played, and it's the coolest groove. It just sounds huge. So I chose that because, like, the song in general is really cool, but I thought, like, the drum part, like, was just, like, so grimy and so hooky that I could not, like, throw that in there.
That's great, man. I have to listen to that record because I'm not really familiar. I'm familiar with, you know, Jack White, White Stripes, even some Racketeer, mm-hmm. Racketeer stuff, but I've not really listened to much Dead Weather stuff.
Yeah. That's why I threw it in there, was because, like, you know, I was trying to pick, like, in my top 10, like, some things that weren't, like, all technical, some things that weren't, yeah. Like, some things that just spoke to me, you know, like, wow, like, that's a really cool drum part. You know, I don't care how well performed it is, it's just really good.
No, that's good. That's cool.
And for you?
All right, so,
what are we on, 4?
I don't know. I kind of went out of order a little bit, so I've done.
Croft is not.
I've got my iPad track in front of me, but
oh, okay.
So I got my Soundgarden. I did Permanent Waves and Blood Mountain. So
I think we're on 4.
So I'm on 4.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. So another 2000. I don't know if it came out in 2000 or 99 or whatever. Mission Control from the band Burning Airlines.
Oh, and okay. So I know the band. I don't really know much about him.
The drummer is Peter Moffitt.
Okay.
And this album was one that I picked up never hearing the band before. Just heard all these good things about them.
Cool.
And the guitar player, songwriter in the band, Jay Robbins, was the same guy who was the leader of the band Jawbox, who I really liked.
Yeah, Jay Robbins. Yeah. Okay.
So I really liked his stuff, and I figured, well, if, you know, this is his new band, it's probably pretty cool, and I was right. I mean, the record is great. The whole
is that
album,
the one on that it literally has like a airplane on the cover?
Yeah, it's
right?
Like orange and blue and yellow, and it's it's
okay.
Got like a
I've
like a rocket
seen it,
ship on
listened
it or something.
To it a couple times, yeah, just never.
Yeah, you know, the drumming is just ultra creative. It influenced me a lot when I was doing the Bedford Drive thing.
Because,
you know, we were kind of similar doing the indie rock stuff. It wasn't really emo. It was more the, you know, almost like a harder, you know, harder indie rock type band. Mm-hmm. And they just, I would say, one of the most creative drumming albums that I own. It's just... it's all done tastefully, you know, but he could have played a lot of different things on that record than he did. And as a drummer, it's just inspiring to hear like a lot of the skiffle beats things, and like a lot of you know, use of diddles on the right hand, you know, while you're, you know, not doing much on the hi-hat or the bass drum, just filling space. Mm-hmm. There's a few standout tracks on that album, but the whole thing, from pretty much from top to bottom, is something that you could give somebody that isn't a drummer and just say, listen to this album and tell me what you think. And I would be surprised if that person told you the drumming's pretty crazy in this. So
that's cool. You know, knew about the band for forever, never really.
The songs aren't all that technical. They're not all that. It's not proggy, you know, prog rock or anything. So it's not like you kind of have to do the things he's doing on there. He's just. I almost feel like they just told him, hey, we wrote these tunes, see what you come up with. He came up with like some cool stuff, and they never told him to water it down.
Yeah, they were just like, go with what you have, right?
So it for that reason, I just think it's a cool record.
So on that note, like, do you think like the production was as important as the parts?
No.
Okay.
No, the production is solid. There's nothing there's nothing fancy about it. There's nothing like, I would never go to somebody and be like, hey, I want that drum sound.
Okay.
But I would, I also wouldn't say that
hey,
it was,
I want that.
Yeah.
No, you don't.
I okay. Yeah, cool. I also wouldn't say that it doesn't sound bad or anything. I wouldn't say don't give me that drum sound, but it's not one that sticks out.
You know what sticks out to me as a bad drum sound with like decent drumming?
Oh, never mind. It's not singing here. Never mind.
Remember the band The Anniversary?
Yeah.
If we're on that, you know, tip. Their first record, Designing a Nervous Breakdown. Worst drum sound ever.
Is that the album with the D in Detroit or something like that?
Yeah, okay. That is. And it's probably the worst drum sound ever. It might work for the record, though. I don't know. I'd have to go back and re-listen.
It's not memorable to me, so.
No, but, like, I just feel like, oh, my God. Like, if this drum sound was better, the whole record would be 1,000 times better, you know?
Yeah.
I don't know who recorded that or mixed or whatever. Like, it sounds terrible. But, like, it's one of those things where you're just like, what the hell happened? You know, like, good song,
who's in charge of
and
this?
Terrible production. Yeah.
All right.
Moving
ahead. Along.
Yeah.
Do you need another beer?
Yeah, whenever you're ready.
All right. Go ahead.
Let's do one more. Okay. So,
this is five?
Number five.
All right.
So, this is my, where I get cussed out or yelled at on Facebook.
This is your controversial.
There's
pick?
A lot of controversy from here on out.
Alright.
Okay,
all right.
So once again, we're not talking about engineering. We're not, from my end, we're not talking about we're talking about, from me right here, is impact. Okay, so this is an impact song. Like, Anniversary, D in Detroit would be like, production bothers me. This one just like won me over from day one, and it's you can come over and punch me in the face. Okay, so the song I'm so terrified to say this right now in front of Croft, because I feel like he's gonna come over here and hit me in the head, but the song is Bawa to Ba from Kid Rock.
What the hell's wrong with you?
Exactly.
Yeah.
But that song, when I heard that Tom Phil, boom, 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 total new metal bullshit. But, like, I thought, like, that drum part was just, like, so perfect for that, you know, whatever you want to call it, like the space.
I didn't hear that. I didn't see that coming, Ryan.
I know. That's why I told you. I said there's gonna be some fist throwing.
I don't think it's that controversial, though. I mean, I think it's... I mean, it sounds like that's a personal pick.
It's a personal pick, but at the same time, I thought, like, it was... That was the year of 98, I believe. Maybe 90.
Wasn't a lot of great 99, music out in 98.
Somewhere around there. And you had real drums playing a hip-hop groove. Okay. And I thought that was like the, like, you had the, I think the opening line from that song was like, you know, I don't know what it was, but it was really like hi-hat driven, you know, in the verse, very 16th note. Really simple, but it went from, this is not a drum machine. Could tell, you know, this is rock and roll infused with rap, and that's what really like kind of made me go like, oh shit, like this can be done. Like, you can have a live band behind you. It's not Limp Bizkit. You can have a live band behind you and have rap going on.
Okay, I don't hate you for it. I don't hate you for it.
Yeah, I think it's you right. Do a
no,
little bit.
If you said Nickelback, then I would have.
No, it's no Nickelback.
Then it would have been a different story, I think, but.
I like the drum tone on that at the time. I haven't listened to it in a long while, but I thought everything fit well.
No, that's
I
cool.
think that was recorded at Temper Mill or something,
Temper
too.
Temper Mill.
Which
you,
is...
You ever recorded there before?
I have.
You
yeah.
have?
Yeah.
Sweet. We'll have to talk
Dave
about that sometime.
Feeney. Yeah.
Yeah. When I said personal pick, these are all personal picks. I guess what I was just saying is I don't think that would be... something you'd hear from many other people drumming wise, so it's cool that it's something different.
Yeah, so. I mean, no judging.
No, that's cool. We're not judging here, unless you pick Nickelback.
Nope, no Nickelback.
All right, so I'm gonna do one that's a going back a little bit to the 90s here, or maybe late 80s. What actually might have been the first CD I ever bought with my own money.
Holy
after
shit.
I got a CD player.
Okay.
And the drumming to this day is still awesome to me.
Twisted Sister.
That's it. Yeah.
Is it?
No.
Oh. Shit.
Time's Up by Living Color.
Ooh, okay. Living Color, yes.
Drummer is Will Calhoun.
Yeah.
And one of the first songs I learned how to play on drums was Pride. So listen to that drum fill.
Pride. Okay.
Doom, doo, doom, cha, doom, doo, doo, cha.
Like,
you listen to that first thing, that first, you know, lick, the drum part, I don't even know how you count that out. Like, it's almost like a feel thing. Like, when you,
yeah,
you know, because it comes in, the main riff comes, the drums come on an upbeat. But it's, when you tap it out, it doesn't fit. Like, it doesn't, it almost, it's almost
so
like...
So it doesn't, like, go with a tempo or
right.
whatever.
Like,
okay.
Just the first part of it, you know, that does. But when he does the fill to get into the song, into the rest, bring the whole band in, I don't, like, they must have just...
They
I almost feel like they played that...
Or something,
no,
or?
I almost feel like they just played it in the room with each other. Like,
okay.
It almost sounds like they recorded it live. And I didn't do any... research on that record or anything like that. I probably should, because I like that record a lot. But the drums are huge in that. The snare, it's not drowning in reverb. It just sounds like a lot of room sound.
Mm-hmm.
But every time you just hear the snare, it's pop, pop, every hit. But it's not a lot of reverb, so when he does do some busier stuff, it's not all cloudy. But the drums sound great on that record. Unbelievable use of the hi-hat in a song called New Jack Theme, I think it is, it's called, or I'll have to look up the name of that
so
song.
So is the drummer like technical, or
yeah.
is he like just kind of...
Yeah, Will Calhoun okay. has got some serious chops, but
okay.
he's got some serious groove. Let me pull up the name of the song that I'm thinking of, because I want people
yeah.
at home to kind of be able to reference it. But basically, if you don't know Living Color at all, I'm not talking about the TV show. in living color.
Jim Carrey.
Yeah, it. These guys just have some serious groove to it. Yeah, New Jack theme. So some really, really cool hi-hat stuff going on in there. We'll have to check it out like during our little break when we get another beer. I'll show it to you and see what you think.
Yes.
Pride, again, one of the first songs I learned how to play drums to. Time's Up is sick. It's like a double time type thing, but he's doing a lot of crazy stuff in there. Type is another song. And then Love Rears Its Ugly Head is a slower tune, but the pocket is just so played so beautifully. You know, it's just he lays in, he's got this wicked drum sound, and he does just enough, you know, to be more than just like an AC/DC type approach to like
he's not just throwing down like
right. But these guys just have sick groove to it, and it's a great album. So check that out if you haven't already done that. Time's Up by Living Color. That album came out in 1990. So before all the grunge stuff, really.
Yeah, we were pretty young at the time. Okay.
So
cool.
While we're getting, we're going to take a little break here.
Yes.
But before we do that, I want to bring up a couple people's submissions on Facebook here. Things that.
Okay, let me hear these. I'm going to.
Yeah, let's.
I want to hear from the audience.
Let's hear from the peeps out there.
The people.
What do the people have to say? So.
Jay is like a master with this what is that, an iPad or something? He's like,
oh, it's just an iPad flying mini.
For those of you not seeing this, because you're not seeing this, he's got that left thumb going like it's Mach 3 on his iPad right now.
Sorry.
Go ahead.
All right, so let me kind of go in order here a little bit. We got quite a bit of comments, so this is really cool. So John, we mentioned John talking about David Silvera's snare being different than anything else at that time.
It was, he's right on.
So that was about Korn.
Yep.
Our buddy Tim Pack.
I love Tim.
Saint what Anger.
Up,
Saint
Pack. Anger. Yeah,
specifically the snare drum sound.
I feel like he's being facetious.
I think he is. I think sorry, I don't know Papa if Randy, we already mentioned your mention of Free Will by Rush, but I really like his comment. I don't know, Randy. I don't know if you're drinking or
what did Randy say here.
Randy says bullshit. Play Free Will by Rush. Fuck all the other dumb shit.
Oh. My response to that is, you have free will to do whatever you want.
Yeah, so...
And he did.
So thanks, Randy.
I like it.
James Anthony, you know James?
Yeah,
James, I played with James. Yeah. Have you played with James before?
I have, okay. Multiple bands, times.
James says, my favorite floor tom hit is the Beatles cut of Mr. Moonlight off Beatles for Sale.
Okay.
Not familiar with the floor tom hit.
No. I'm sure it's a great sounding recording.
Yes.
Thank you, James.
He's got some reference to Elvin Jones here, which is an amazing jazz drummer.
Yeah.
We didn't really get into the jazz stuff.
Yeah,
like I did put a couple non-rock albums, not on my top 10, but it's just things to check out.
Yeah.
Because they inspired me or whatever, but not... I wanted to try and keep it to rock just because I was trying to keep it relatable to most people.
Yeah, and you know, like when you say that, like to me, like... You know, like, I'm sure they're, you know, like, Buddy Rich, Elvin Jones, you know, all these people, like, are wonderful drummers, but, like, we're trying to touch on, like, what we love, you know, which is more of the rock and roll genre. So, no diss to these drummers, you know, because they're insanely good. We know about them. We've seen them, studied them or whatever, but... We're trying to do, you know, like what's in our wheelhouse. So.
Right. I'm going to skip some of these other comments because they reference some things I think we're going to get into in the next segment here. But so I'm going to skip this one here. But so our buddy Zeke,
Oh, yeah.
He mentioned Danny Carey of Tool on Ticks and Leeches.
He's not on my list.
But he's on my honorable mention.
Okay.
But I'll get into that. We'll get into that later. I mean, it was almost like a crime not having Danny Carey on that list. But
I will tell you why he's not on my list later.
Okay.
Actually.
So. Well, he mentions this song, Ticks and Leeches, which I'm not really good with song names, so I'm not really sure what song it is. The only Tool songs I remember the names to that are not like the big hits are like 46 and 2. That wasn't a radio hit.
An awesome song.
That was probably the one that like I heard it was like, damn, this guy is like, you know, he's playing, was it Pentuplets or I don't know what he was doing.
I think he was at the end. Yeah.
Of that song.
46 and 2 had like some crazy solos in it. I know we're going to take a break here, so I'll make this quick. Ticks and Leeches was an insane song. Like, great performance. And I'll get into why, like, old Danny Carey to me is better than new Danny Carey. New, as in 10 years ago, Danny Carey. But yeah, like, we'll get into why he's not on my list.
All right.
Okay.
So, Zeke just mentioned that, and then
I like that, though.
Mike Portnoy of Dream Theater on Damage Incorporated cover.
Okay. Let's take a break.
So,
I know you have advertisements to get to, you know.
Advertisements.
You gotta pay some bills.
No, there's no advertisements. We'll take
not
a break.
Yet.
We'll take a break. But what I will do is a little plug here for Warm Chord Music. So we just got the new tune "Haunted Dreams" on Pandora. So nice. If you are not, if you're a Pandora listener and you don't have a station called Warm Chord Music, please add it. It helps me out. It will go a long way in getting that song played on other people's stations. So far, the good news is that it's been live on Pandora for 2 weeks, and we've already got over 2,000 plays.
That's damn good.
Which is cool.
It's
I don't know
impressive.
How that happened yet. Yeah. We've got 20 listeners as far as 20 stations created from it. I know a handful of that is from you guys out there that have been supportive, you know, through Instagram and Facebook and stuff like that. And I've mentioned it, but there's people from all over the country I'm seeing, in places that I don't know people, like in
that's cool
places in Nevada, not Las Vegas. So it's cool to see that. So I wanted to thank you guys out there for supporting Warm Chord Music and all the college radio stations out there that have been playing it. Last bit of news on that is we were on the college radio charts, started at over 400 out of about 800 and something, worked our way up to 184 last week. We're down to 236 this week, but you know, there's a lot more time to go in this 3-month campaign we're working on. So I just wanted to kind of mention it to you guys out there. If you haven't downloaded it yet or gone to Spotify or Pandora, check it out. Please do that. And we're gonna go ahead and take a quick break, get another beer, play a couple tunes, and why don't we do this while we're waiting? We'll play out a tune from Living Color,
okay,
to give people an idea what that's all about, and then we'll come back.
Beautiful. When I speak out loud,
All right, welcome back to Warm Chord Music Podcast, episode 9. We're talking about favorite drum recordings, and we left off at number 5. We did some comments from Facebook, too. So we just got done grabbing a couple brewskis, and we're good to go. And Ryan, you listened to a little Living Color before that. What did you think? You weren't familiar with that record, would you?
No,
think?
I was not. Such a good drum sound. Actually, the overall record sounded really live, really maybe recorded in the same room or something. But drum sound wise, if we want to focus on that, just like a really open snare drum, really tight kick to bass guitar. All I can say is that if you've not checked out that record, like I have not, make sure you do if you appreciate like a really tight, live-sounding recording.
Cool. So we're going to keep it going with you. Or hell, do you want to keep
yeah.
going
okay.
that way?
So, yeah, I'm gonna move on.
You gonna give me another? You gonna give me another Kid Rock record now?
No, I'm not. But I will say, like, there's a place for that kind of era in all this. You know, like if you want to do Limp Bizkit, Korn, Kid Rock, whatever it is. You know, there's that place though. You know, yeah. in there, and I think we gotta recognize that as musicians, which that's kind of. For better, for worse, whatever you want to call it, that's there. It shaped us in some way, and we take the good and we leave the bad. I hope.
Yeah. Well, there is at least one band from that era that didn't make it on my list, but drum wise, I know would make some people's list. So I don't want to steal any thunder. So I'm gonna let you go next. And do you have anybody from that era at all?
Well. I'm going to go with what's next on my list.
Okay.
And we will avoid Beastie Boys.
Okay.
Check Your Head album, the song Pass the Mic. I believe this was recorded no drum machine, no, you know, sampling anything. And this would have been 94, 93, somewhere around there.
You're saying that album didn't have any samples on it?
No, I'm not saying that. I'm saying this song was definitely played live on drums.
Oh, like so Heart Pass, Attack Man? Or
Pass the Mic was definitely played. See, this is where I get bad with Beastie Boys because they all played instruments. I don't know who played what. I don't know if it was like Ad Rock or... Mike Diamond played the drums on this, but someone played the drums on Pass the Mic, and it was just the coolest drum. Mike probably won't pick this up, but it was like the groove was like, you know, real simple.
Uh-huh.
But once again, it was very open and sounded very Bonham-like. You know, just real ringy, no bullshit, no, you could tell that there might have been compression on it, but it was like tuning or whatever was that was not even considered, you know, just like, let's just throw down drum track, get it done. I'm the ADROCK and the place to be, and I'm going all the way. I got the... You know, it's just very raw rap, very raw drums. I don't really know what the hell was going on with other instrumentation. There could have been a freaking Mellotron on there for all I know, but drums stuck out to me.
Gotcha. Okay, well, that's cool. Well, you have a rap background. I mean, you have your own rap persona, I guess.
Yes.
You know, in Ratso.
Yeah.
Little plug face. For Ratso.
Yeah.
Okay.
Hey, so, Ratso, coming at you.
That's right. What are we gonna hear another Ratso song or record, dude? You got some old stuff that I still don't know.
Paul Witt's been begging for the Ratso, man.
I've heard some shit before that never got released, at least I don't think did.
There's a bunch of stuff.
One of you made a reference to Mike Tyson even, and I don't remember what song that was, but it was hilarious.
Yeah.
But my point is we gotta talk about Ratso in the future.
That's another
But you have a background with hip hop and rap and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. So I mean it's not surprising to hear you bring in that in your drum recording, so that's cool. Yeah. That's cool you're bringing that side of it into it.
Yeah, I thought like Beastie Boys were like like people never thought of them as a real band. You know, they just, you know, they latched on to their first album, License to Ill. You know, which a lot of it was actually, you know, like you had real guitar on there and stuff. And then you had their second album, Paul's Boutique, which was really...
my favorite record.
Probably mine as well. Like, you had, like, insane, like, samples. Dust Brothers did that. And then you had, I think right after that was, I could be wrong here, but in my brain right now it says it's Check Your Head. You know, and that was the one with Pass the Mic on it. And they all come from a punk background, you know, listening to Bad Brains and all that. And, you know, for me, it's like when I heard the Beastie Boys kind of go back on, was it Ill Communication, Check Your Head? What, I don't know what the hell. I can't keep things straight in my brain. Ill
Communication, there was definitely some full band performances. I think it was like Tough Guy and Heart Attack Man. There was some drums, real live guitar drums going on.
I think it was Ill. Yeah, dude, like I said, I can't keep this shit straight in my brain anymore. So the album with Pass the Mic on it, whatever that is.
Oh, okay. So my number six.
Yeah.
Verses by Pearl Jam. So this is by far my favorite Pearl Jam record for drumming. Probably my favorite Pearl Jam record overall. Most people that I know, 10 is their favorite.
Yeah.
And that's a great record, obviously, for different reasons. But as a drummer, when I heard Dave Abruzzese or Abruzzese,
whatever the hell that is,
play on that record, I was blown away. And a lot of it is his syncopated fills, like you know he'll do like two cymbals, like 16th note, you know.
Yeah, you were always great at that. Oh, I will say, like, I always took a note from page from your book, whatever you want to call it, on that, like, ba-da.
That, well, then you're taking a page out of Abruzzese's book, because that's where I got it from.
Well, so that's
all
you
him
taught
right
me that, like, in Bedford. I hope you can edit this out if you want.
But, I'm not gonna.
Like, you know, like I always like heard that in Bedford, and I was like, wow, this is very not natural to me. You know, and really? when I had to play stuff that was on the record that had that in there, I had to condition myself to do that because it wasn't like the left hand crash was never natural to me, like because I'm right-handed.
Oh, that's right.
Okay. So like coming in and going ba-da, like I had to learn that, which I like now because I learned it probably from, you know, practicing from your parts. So
well, that's cool, man.
Yeah. That's very cool.
Probably the only reason that I have a splash cymbal today is to do those kind of fills. And I think it's like an 11-inch K splash that I have. And I put it right where my second tom would normally be on my right-hand side. Because that's just a part of my playing. And for a while I tried to... you know, I tried not to ignore it, but, you know, to try to do other things. And, you know, with the new song that came out with Haunted Dreams, the fill that I needed to write for that breakdown, it just, you know, it's natural for me to play that way. And Dave Abruzzese is the reason for that. He has probably more to do with my style of drumming than any other drummer.
Wow.
Yeah, there's a lot of other drummers that I can say are favorites or that I think are great. But if there's one drummer I'd have to say that I patterned myself after, he's probably the closest thing to it. John Bonham awesome. And Dave Abbruzzese. John Bonham, every drummer would love to say that because yeah. John Bonham's a legend. But sure. I think it's a crime that Dave Abbruzzese did not get put in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame with the rest of Pearl Jam. I think it's bullshit.
Was that because he wasn't an original?
I don't know because almost every other drummer is in there. It makes no sense. He was on one record, two records, actually. He played on part of Vitalogy.
That's weird. Yeah, that's bizarre.
I don't get it.
And he never made the Hall of Fame.
I think that was the Hall of Fame's decision, not Pearl Jam's, because there's actually support from the rest of the band to have him in there.
That's
no differently
bizarre.
Than Dave Mustaine is not in with Metallica. Now, Dave Mustaine wasn't on any of the records, so that's the argument there.
So right. Why wouldn't he say, or why wouldn't like management or Eddie Vedder say, like, we're not joining your shit unless you...
Dude.
Okay, that's another conversation.
Yeah.
Right?
I don't disagree with you necessarily, but I mean...
Because like if
I like Pearl Jam enough to not be pissed at him for that, but at the same time, I think it's bullshit.
I think that's complete
because
trash.
Because his fingerprints are all over that record as far as the way that it grooves and you know, listen to Glorified G. It's kind of a deep cut on that album. There's a sick fill in that song during the bridge, and I can't sound it out with my mouth because it wouldn't make any sense, but it's got that fill, it's got that syncopated cymbal thing all over it. And you hear that, and when I heard that, I was like, oh my God, what is that? It was one of those rewind the tape deals, right? When you listen to a song and like, oh, this is good. And then you hear something, you're like, holy shit.
How do I do that, right? Like, how does that?
So that was like, that was always like kind of my MO with any band that I was in is I want to do some things to add some color to the to the song with drum parts, but then I want there to be a moment where you have to listen, where you listen to it, like rewind that. So
yeah.
What's on yours next?
Okay. So moving on. Covered. So Zeppelin, Levy Breaks, not to get too cliche.
Yeah. Man, that's
so why I chose that particular song was because obviously you had the freaking great drum sound of Zeppelin, right? You know, and then Beastie Boys took that same tune. They were the first, maybe not the first, but allegedly the first ones, like MCA, took that loop, ran it around his apartment on a tape, and played it over and over again. That's how they did their song on License to Ill. He was the first guy to, like, sample, like, a full loop and say, like, I'm going tape around my whole apartment. Like, it wasn't Pro Tooled, obviously, then. You know, he actually, like, kept splicing this goddamn loop of this drum beat.
Man.
Yeah.
That's
why
nuts.
I chose that one. Because it was awesome beat, freaking John Bonham, and it transferred over to the hip-hop realm.
Right. No, that's cool, man. Yeah. All right, so next on my list is going to be possibly one of the best drum sounds I've heard on a record. And that's Blood Sugar Sex Magik, Red Hot Chili Peppers, and one of my favorite drummers, Chad Smith.
Yeah, he's awesome.
Talk about a pocket groove drummer that has the flair to pull off all the crazy shit that you've ever heard.
That guy can do anything he wants, and you don't even realize it. Yes.
Yeah, so the very first track, Power of Equality, this the snare drum is just like, I don't know. I always wanted that snare sound, you know. And the one thing I read about it, if I recall, and it was some magazine I read about, I think what they did was they actually had the close mic on the snare panned in one speaker, and then they took a shotgun mic back further in the room, pointed it directly at
shotgun, like a field recording mic, okay.
And pointed it at the snare, and that's panned completely the other direction.
Weird.
So I tried to do stuff like that, like mimic that, where like I had, you know, or I don't, and actually I don't know that the close mic was panned left. I think it was just the shotgun mic that was hard panned in the other direction.
I wonder where the...
And that's a trick that they've used a couple times, I think.
With the shotgun mic?
Yeah.
Up there? Okay. What was it, like an NTG?
I don't know. I mean, it could have been a Sennheiser. I don't know. But that was what I read about that sound, because it's not... Unlike the Living Color record we just listened to, except for a couple songs, you got almost the same, the drum sound and the snare's huge almost every song. Sounds like the only thing they might have done is kind of back down the room mics a little bit, you know, maybe, I don't know. But with the Chili Peppers record, you don't hear that effect again. You hear the loud snare, the roomy snare at times, but it's cool. There was some trickery done here and there to get that sound. But that's the first thing drum-wise you hear is just how huge that snare and how three-dimensional it is. And part of it is he knows how to hit the damn drums. You know, he's just gets the most out of those drums. But, you know, Funky Monks, I mean, you know, if you have to ask, I Could Have Lied. I mean, these are all songs where just... You just sit back and listen to the drums, and you're like, God damn, like, as a drummer, like...
Yeah, you just love it, right?
If I had that kind of drum sound, if I'm sitting in a room and I heard my... It, actually, you know what? It is like this. You ever get at a gig at a venue, and the drums sound so good, you're so happy with the way your drums sound, that you almost don't...
You forget you're playing.
Yeah, and you almost don't want to overplay or play more, because you just want to hear the drums breathe.
Yeah,
that's that record to me. All right, so what's next on your list?
Okay, well, I'm gonna go to "Around the Fur" by Deftones.
All right, I was waiting for Deftones. I thought there would be one in here. So,
"Around the Fur" album, "Around the Fur" song. So you recall, how it started with that kick drum, and I was listening to it back today, and I'm like, well, this isn't the best sounding thing in the world, but like,
it's big,
that shit as a drummer, big, yeah, man. that jams, right? I'm like, of course, as a drummer, you pick up on those nuances with the little ghost note on the snare drum, right? The hi-hat lift. As a normal person, you're like, I don't know what's happening, but it sounds cool. Thought that was really cool because at that point, in time, how many songs started with a freaking drum part? I don't know. Any?
There's not a lot. Yeah.
Yeah.
Maybe Keep Them Separated by the Offspring.
Or the Breeders.
Oh yeah, Cannibal. Or?
Yeah, Cannibal.
Yeah.
Whatever it was. Yeah. That's probably not the right.
No, that's a good one, dude. Who's the drummer? Is that Abe Cunningham?
Abe Cunningham.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I thought that was like this coolest frickin' like I don't know what that song said, but it said like toughness about it. You know, it had some kind of like, we're starting with how cool is that? Like, you know, that's a badass. That may as well be like the coolest guitar riff ever.
I hear that, and I kind of wonder, like, did they write the riff around that drum part, or did the drums, did he like write that as a compliment to like the guitar part, and they decided to start the song that way?
I would assume he wrote that drum part.
This sounds like something. Yeah. How many times have you sat in your basement, like, just, and you play that drum beat?
Yeah.
Just because, you know, or before band practice, and then, yeah, you know, that's like,
I still play that riff on the drums, like, all the time, just to warm up to a drum part. Cause it's like, gets your foot going. You know, it's...
One funny story off of this has nothing to do with Deftones, but it has to do with playing, like, a drum beat on your own of a song that you liked. So, as a kid, before I really understood, like, music that much, one of my favorite records was Dr. Feelgood by Motley Crue.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, Tommy
great,
Lee.
Great album.
I still love that song, Dr. Feelgood. So,
great album.
Like, it opens up again on the same, on the snare hit. It opens up, the hi-hat opens up there too. So one time we're playing band practice with the cover band. I was in the DR5, and Mike Conception knows like every song. He's like a human jukebox for guitar, basically. So I'm sitting down there, awesome. And all of a sudden, Mike starts playing. And I'm like, all of a sudden, like, the hair on the back of my neck stood up, and I thought I was like 1989 or whatever. Oh my God, he knows this. Like, I'm actually going to play this with somebody. You know, like, it was one of those moments. Yeah. So it'd been like if you were playing Around the Fur, and all of a sudden, like, Ed or somebody's, you know, let's play the whole thing. You know? Yeah, no, that's cool, man. I like that pick. That's a and the drums sound great on that record too. I know we're not all.
That's a Terry Date.
Is it?
Yeah, Terry Date.
And didn't he do the first one too, though?
Yeah, he did.
How drastic of a difference in drum sound?
I think like Terry Date was on a budget probably for the first one.
It's definitely more polished. But it's big sounding.
Yeah, it's huge. I mean, that's. To me, like, when you say Deftones, that's Deftones.
That's cool.
I skipped, did I tell you this last podcast we did? I skipped, the first time I skipped school was to see Deftones ever. First time skipping high school was to see Deftones with Layla D'Amato. Remember her?
Yeah.
Yeah. So, we went and we saw Deftones. It was, like, in May. Of like our senior year.
Wow, man! The only time
I ever skipped school was Deftones show. Yeah.
Well, if that's a good reason to do it, I guess, right?
Hell yeah,
it's good. Even it could have been Nickelback.
Could have been anybody. So who you got?
All right, next one for me. We're kind of sticking. I'm gonna stick with the metal here, kind of.
Okay.
All right.
Let's go.
Rust in peace, Megadeth. Nick Menza on the drums.
Nick Menza was a genius.
Nick Menza was the son of a jazz musician.
Was he not? He was endorsed by Tama, right? I believe.
I think it was either Tama or Yamaha drums that he played at the time.
Okay.
Yeah, he was the drum tech for Megadeth on the So Far So Good So What tour. And there was issues with Chuck Baylor. He was, you know, drug addiction, just like most of the band was at that time.
Okay.
Anyway, he filled in for him and took over. And the guy is today, to me, one of the most precise metal drummers. I just think that, you know, Megadeth sounded the way that the tightest they ever have and probably ever will have, partly because of Nick Menza. Rust in Peace, I'd heard Megadeth before Rust in Peace, and it was kind of hard to leave out Gar Samuelson, and I think it's Chris Marzek on Facebook had actually wanted to, you know, shout out to him, he wanted to bring up Peace Sells with Who's Buying, so I wanted to wait to mention that until now when I brought up Megadeth. But yeah. I think you knew we weren't going to make it through this podcast without Megadeth being brought up.
No, it's so awesome.
Yeah, Menza, I've seen him play live twice. I saw him on the Euthanasia tour and the Cryptic Writings tour. But one of the things I'll say about him is, you know, a lot of drummers, especially amateur drummers, you know, that aren't used to playing, you know, on tours and stuff professionally. When you see a drummer that goes from their snare to their toms, a lot of times the volume drops off on the toms.
Yeah.
You know, compression can only do so much in the studio for that kind of thing.
Right.
But live, it's really noticeable. He hit... It's almost like the guy hit just as hard on his toms as
he
his snares.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah. It is. I mean, you heard everything when he played. He's so energetic. He made comments about how if he... You know, he almost second-guessed what he did on Rust in Peace after he had to play it live because it was such a workout, you know. But that's one of those things where I listen to that record and I almost think, like, I can't hear any other drum part. Mm-hmm. You know, like, drum parts. Like, that whole album, really.
He's perfect.
Yeah, it just sounds perfect.
Writing-wise,
I mean, the sound is great. They remixed that record later, and the snare sounds a little tighter. If you listen to the older version, you can actually hear the bottom head of the snare. The snare
is better.
I don't know. I love the I think the remix remaster sounds amazing. But okay. If you want to go back and listen to the original, if you can find it, you'll hear the snares buzzing a little bit more. So you almost kind of hear the. He doesn't really play a lot of ghost notes on that record, but. You hear things a little differently, I guess. I don't know if it's better or not better, but I would say some of the most precise drumming I've ever heard. And it's even, consistent throughout the whole record. The fills are amazing, and that album is responsible for a lot of the fills that I used to play or still play to this day, where you take your snare and your kick drum and your toms and you basically cut up like a 16th note or 16th notes or triplets, so you know he does that fill in Tornado of Souls, so like right in the middle, and it's just drums, and I heard that, and again, that's one of those rewind the tape moments, right?
Yeah. Like, what the hell is going on
so
here?
All he really is doing is, you know, you take 16th notes, you know, and you just say, okay, you know, take the snare on the 1E and then the kick drum and and mm-hmm. then you do that all around the toms. And at the time, I'm like, what is he doing? You know, my drum teacher at the time was like, oh, well, all he's really doing is he's just taking 16th notes and he's just... that's all he's doing. And because I was learning drums, I think I was probably 12 or 13, you know, I'm like, oh, that's what he's doing. But he was so even, it's just so fluid. It's you know, it's a metal record, you know, so it's gonna have more on it. It's definitely not one of those records that it's just, you know, it's not so much about the groove or whatever. It's more about it's a little flashy, you know, I guess, but very tasteful, and everything he does serves the song.
It's cool.
So Rust in Peace. But I easily could have picked something from Gar Samuelson, like Killing Is My Business, But Business Is Good, or it's a great album title, right?
Yeah.
Or Peace Sells But Who's Buying. Gar Samuelson, I'll say
Killing Is My Business and Business Is Good.
Like they're actually gonna release a remixed version of that, or like something. They're gonna do something with that. They're reissuing it soon, but
that's cool.
Probably one of the most underrated drummers. All right. what's your next pick?
Okay, so my next pick is Hum, Downward As Heaven.
Okay,
and
this is good because I got the opposite. I've got You Prefer an Astronaut, even though Downward As Heavenward is probably my favorite album as a whole.
Okay.
You Prefer an Astronaut is
that is a great
for
tune.
Drums.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I did Downward Is Heavenward, the album, and the song. Like,
I don't even remember the song.
So the song, yeah, I'm not going to try and sing it. But
yeah, come on, dude.
It was...
You've already rapped.
It was very... once again, going with my theme of just really open, cymbal washy, just a cool track, right? Like, I cannot remember the damn drummer's name for the life.
His name is Brian Saint. I don't know if it's Pierre,
Pierre,
but it's P E R E. So I don't know if that's
Pierre. Yeah, it's Brian Saint Pierre.
Yeah.
So, just a freaking great drum track, right? You have like just cymbals like laying over each other, just like the cymbals do not stop through the whole track. So that's why I picked that. Thought that was a great album, great song. Downward Is Heavenward, great album.
So I picked You'd Prefer an Astronaut.
I love that album too.
So and I will say
why I like Robbins.
Oh yeah,
is the shit.
So that record was a huge influence on my playing, and I think
I love this, dude. We're just like going.
It's like, yeah, man. Like I would say, so Stars, even like the most popular song. And I actually was surprised this album didn't sell nearly as many records as I thought it did.
Yeah, Stars was a great track.
You know, like there's so many of those moments of like things stopping and the drums kind of cue in the rest of the band.
Yep.
And he picks the perfect fills.
Yes.
To do that with, right?
Yes.
So yep. Another song, I Hate It Too.
Yep.
The drums in that. Why I Like Robbins, you mentioned that one. I Like Your Hair Long.
Yeah. I Like Your Hair Long. I don't know what,
and Ladled to the Ground. You prefer an astronaut.
Do you prefer?
It's a great record overall, but I mean, the drums sound great.
Awesome,
they sound amazing.
Yeah.
I'd like to do a little bit of research on how they recorded those, because the toms sound great. I remember the toms just sounding really, really good on
that
record.
I wonder who did all that.
The kick drum sound, the whole drums just, and I think a lot of that too is he plays with a lot of power. He's a powerful drummer.
You can hear like his snare hand, like just like bashing that shit.
Yeah, he's a powerful drummer.
He's not letting up.
The pod
was, you know, that was the opening track on that record,
second,
right?
The second song? Okay. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah,
the first song is it like Little Dipper or something like that.
Little Dipper.
I don't know. It was one. There's a few fillers on that record. Mm-hmm. I think that's one of them. Weird that your opener is like a filler song, but
yeah.
But
that was kind of that like era, you know.
Yeah,
where it was like you could get away with like a 2 minute intro.
I got a VHS like tape of Sonic Reducer playing one of its first shows at the Mosquito Club playing Stars. And my drum kit.
It is awesome.
Yeah, I have it. And I just got one of those VHS to like digital converters.
Like a converter, yeah.
So I'm gonna put that shit on YouTube. And it's funny because like, you know, like my drum kit's huge. I've got like two Chinas.
Yeah,
and, like
I
got
a rack.
It's crazy, dude. It's totally inappropriate. I'm hitting everything, you know.
That's cool.
But yeah, so You Prefer an Astronaut. This is a very influential time. I mean, that came out like 95, I think, 94, 95.
Yeah. That was like a weird era.
Right after grunge was kind of dying
That's
out.
That's what I'm saying. Like, yeah, like it was a weird era where like you had like grunge and then all of a sudden you had this like weird like in between of like, what was that? What is that called even? I don't know.
Post-grunge.
Like it was alternative.
Yeah, you know? Exactly.
It was a strange time, and like
It was a strange time.
Well, we were all privy to it, but most people weren't.
I think it was a great time, though. I mean, I think that 1991 to like 95, like there was some really cool things coming out. So,
yep.
So what's okay? What, this is your last one, right? On your top 10.
Okay.
What do you got?
So, as you know, I made some reserves. But I will go
drum
with,
roll.
I'm gonna go with Smashing Pumpkins, Cherub Rock.
Okay, so your number one and my number one are the same.
Oh shit!
All okay. right, there well, you go. Show's over.
And we're done.
I wouldn't have picked the same song, so that's cool. This is a talking point. So,
yeah.
So tell me about Cherub Rock. Tell me about Siamese Dream, what that meant to you.
Okay, so the only reason why I picked Cherub Rock, I mean, we've heard Gish. We've heard...
I love Gish.
Yeah, Gish is great. But, man, something about that, like, crush roll.
Dynamics.
Well, like, something about that, man. Just, like, I'm like, holy shit. Like, really got my interest. Like, I'm like, okay, something's happening here. And then the coolest thing about Cherub Rock to me, if you listen to Cherub Rock, tell me that there's not some, like, tape residual shit on there vocally. Where it shouldn't be. First verse, when it comes in, it actually comes in like a couple like takes later, and you can actually hear Billy Corgan singing underneath.
I'll have to listen. I've never noticed that.
Listen to Cherub Rock, and like I think it's like stuck on the tape where he's not in on verse one. But there's, like, some kind of, like, shit they couldn't delete because it was on the tape. And you can... Okay. Right? And then all of a sudden it's like, boom! Boom! Like, it's like
I
his
never
verse
heard that.
Comes in.
That's something to listen
and
to.
And I'm like, holy shit, like, he's singing before, and it's the shit's already, you know... It was tracked, and it was stuck on that tape. So
that's,
listen
that's
to
different.
It. Yeah.
I have to check that out, man.
And then you got the swiftness of Chamberlain's fills on that song, and like just like so it felt so good. It was rock and roll, but it felt like it wasn't.
Well, I think the thing with Jimmy Chamberlain though is that he's kind of like Neil Peart, even if. You're not a drummer, or you don't know drumming, you know how damn good he is.
Yeah.
And if you're a drummer, your appreciation for what he's doing is even greater. Because as a drummer, right. You know, like, dude, this guy's not just like some gorilla in a drum kit, like, who's just pounding drums, right? He actually knows what the hell he's doing. He knows the rudiments around the kit. He's making use of all the tools a drummer has.
Yeah.
Whereas some drummers, you know, I think of some of the old cats, like in the 60s and 70s, like a Bill Ward, like a Mitch Mitchell, like a John Bonham.
Probably didn't know what the hell they were doing, right?
Those guys. Well, I don't know, man. Like, I mean, Bill Ward, dude, like I said in Sweet Leaf,
he was the fucking shit.
Man. Oh, Bill Ward was sick, dude.
Yeah,
and no one
realizes.
No, he is definitely in that list of underrated drummers today. I think if you're like a real metal fan and you really know Sabbath, you don't feel that way. But if you're somebody who's like a casual Sabbath fan or someone who doesn't really pay attention to it too much, you're kind of like, oh yeah, Bill Ward's good, but John Bonham, dude.
And it's
because John Bonham is, dude, Led Zeppelin is like the biggest. You know,
yeah,
arguably
it's the biggest damn band ever.
Yeah, right. Yeah. So, and
Beatles,
I get that. Bonham was a huge influence on most drummers, and definitely on me with his power You know, I mean, listen to the single kick in Good Times, Bad Times. Yeah. You know?
Yeah.
I mean, dude, listen to Date. You know, crazy. You know, one thing I will say, and this is like a, this is really, I want to get back to Jimmy Chamberlain here, but listen to Dazed and Confused.
Oh, my
God. So Dazed and Confused, you got the main riff. So in the middle of all that, you got, like, he's doing all these fills in the middle of the melody. Like, who does right. that? Like, if you
shouldn't even make sense, no. right?
Kind of like Lars drum beats.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. Splash on, like, band of
like,
two.
You ever notice, like, Lars, like, all, and I'm going to talk about Lars in a minute, but he'll hit, like, a cymbal hit, like, after where it should go.
Yeah.
It's almost like his signature thing.
Right. Like, it's like, gang. Like, it's wait, what?
It's like. Yeah.
Okay.
So, so anyway, Bill Ward is definitely an underappreciated drummer. John Bonham deserves the praise. I just think that Bill Ward, you know, especially after going back and listening to more of the stuff lately, I didn't give him enough of his due until recently. So so definitely want to say that. But my whole point of bringing that up was that Jimmy Chamberlain, you can tell he knows what he's playing.
Yeah.
You know, he was more of a jazz drummer before he was in Pumpkins.
Yeah.
So he knew what he was doing. But I will say probably one of the most unique things about Chamberlain was watching him, like, listening to him was one thing, but watching him, just no matter what he's doing on the kit, that hi-hat foot's going up and down all the time.
All the time, that
and
left
And that
foot.
Allows him that ability to fill in a space here or there without doing a snare or a tom fill, but just a, you know, like doing that open hi-hat.
Yeah, because you have that hat going the whole time.
How many drummers have you watched that actually do that?
Yeah.
Or can do
that? I can't do that. Yeah.
I mean, I didn't start having a more active hi-hat foot until I got into Giant. Because I kind of had to with some of the type of stuff we were doing. So he's just an amazing drummer. I had a hard time with whether to pick Siamese Dream or Gish only because I love... there's a few songs on Gish that I love. Like, I Am One. Bury Me.
Awesome song.
But
Snail.
Then,
freaking great song.
But then when I compare Gish to Siamese Dream, I look at how many more of those songs are on Siamese Dream. So Geek USA, which Mike Boyd, shout out to you on Facebook for bringing
shout
that up.
Shout out to Boyd.
Yeah, so he brought up Geek USA. So Geek USA, I mean,
Jelly Belly.
That's on Melancholy.
That's okay. Yeah,
but
you're right.
Still
that's
a great record.
Like second disc of Melancholy. Yeah.
Yeah.
But great.
Quiet.
Yeah.
You know, like, as a drummer, like, wouldn't you want to start a show with that?
Yeah.
Like, hey, Brian, we're getting ready to start our show.
Yeah.
Feedback. Like, playing, like, that's like, with if that doesn't pump you up behind a kit,
right. then fuck you.
You shouldn't play drums, right?
Yeah, right.
So you got that Silver Fuck, which I think he mentioned as well.
Yeah,
that's the name of the song, Silver Fuck. A lot of tom, a lot of hi-hat work in that.
Yep. How about Hummer? Remember Hummer?
Yep.
From that would have been Siamese Dream.
Yep. Rocket.
Great, too.
Yeah.
God, so many good songs.
So anyway, Smashing Pumpkins, Siamese Dream, Cherub Rock, or whatever you want to say. That it's funny, we got to that was both
we
of our number ones.
Down.
And we had
awesome.
Not shared our lists with each other.
Nope. Not before. At all. Like, I had no idea what was on your list.
Yeah, so that's
Croft.
Cool.
Yeah.
So let's
it's pretty cool.
Let's look at some honorable mentions and let's talk about what some of the folks on Facebook had to say.
Yeah.
Let's why don't you go through one of yours or a couple of yours that you've got, and then while you're doing that, I'll pull up some of the Facebook submissions here.
Yeah, sure. So an honorable mention. Kind of bizarre for the average listener. But I have a band called Deerhoof.
Okay.
Greg Saunier is the drummer. Graduated from Berklee School of Music.
Berklee.
Push up the glasses. But anyway, just very bizarre drummer. When you think of a drummer that graduated from like Berklee, you don't think of like some guy that's gonna take chances, right? This guy plays maybe a ride cymbal, a snare drum, and a bass drum. That's it. Or maybe the next gig he plays a bass drum, snare drum, and a floor tom. So he like very much limits himself in terms of like what he can do. He never sets up the same set twice. 16-inch hi-hats or more.
Damn.
Like all the time. Like gigantic.
It's like crash cymbals for hi-hats.
Yeah. The guy's insanely powerful on the drums. Lanky guy, probably like 6'2 or something he looks. But Deerhoof, freaking, I've been praising these guys forever. So
sweet, dude. I'm gonna have to check out Deerhoof.
Deerhoof, man. Fucking, I have on this note, check out Offend Maggie album. Offend Maggie.
Well, we're going to check that out tonight before you leave.
Yes,
I want to check it out.
And is that on Spotify? I have a song, actually. First song. It says, first song. And it says, open, ringy, snare.
Sweet.
So, yeah.
So, you, there's such thing as having an open, ringy snare that doesn't sound like St. Anger?
I mean, Pang. According to my notes, but...
there's a right way to do that sound.
Yes. So, you...
All right, so before I get to the Facebook thing, I'm going to bring up one that almost made my top 10, but I thought it was a little bit too out there for most people. Okay. So back in, I want to say, 2001.
Okay.
Maybe 2002. I was in Bedford Drive. We played at the Shelter, and we opened for a national act called The Exit. And the drummer is Gunnar Olsen, and the name of the album is The New Beat. These guys sound like the Police reincarnated, kind of. Like
that's pretty cool.
And they are all about it. It's kind of
it's almost very reggae.
Yeah.
Or?
Yep. Okay. It's almost as blatant as Greta Van Fleet and Zeppelin. Okay.
Okay.
The difference is that the singer probably doesn't sound anything like Sting, so it's not that. I wouldn't say it's a spitting image of the Police, but the guitars and drums definitely are. And this is everything from the style of drumming to the guitar effects that are used. They're great at what they do, though, and the drummer is probably one of the best drummers I've seen live that played in a band that we played shows with.
Okay.
You know, the guy like has there's a lot of fireworks on that album drum wise. I mean, he's doing a lot of stuff, and he probably plays more than he should at times, I guess, if you want to say, like, if you're getting into that whole, everything is done tastefully, but compared to like a Stuart Copeland's way more reserved. Stuart Copeland is a legendary drummer in his own right. I mean, yeah, I could easily put man, what's the name of that record? I'll have to look it up. I don't want to say it wrong, but it's the one that's got Canary in a Coal Mine and Man in a Suitcase and some of the other real big songs that people know on it. It's got the Pyramid on the record. Zenyatta Mandata or something like that, I think it's called. But anyway, that the new beat from The Exit is a name. It is an out there obscure pick, but it is a band that I played with, and I bought their CD, and ever since I first listened to it, I was just blown away, because a lot of drummers at that time were just not playing that much. And he really did some great stuff, so I wanted to give some props to him. And that band's no longer active as far as I know. They put 2 records out, and unfortunately I don't even think that record is on Spotify or anything. I think you'd have to get it probably on Apple or on iTunes or something. But if you like The Police and you like that kind of style of music and that drummer, then I would highly recommend checking it out, and I can show it to you. I have the disc, so.
Hell yeah, man.
You'll dig it.
That's cool.
Facebook.
Love The Police.
So, Brian Wilson, good friend of ours.
Yeah.
Okay, we went to school with Brian, with Wilson. We always called him Wilson. Wilson!
Wilson!
So, Wilson and I were talking about Smashing Pumpkins, and he brought up Chamberlain. But then he brought up John Fishman from the band Fish.
Okay. Yeah, I've
said,
never been a Fish fan.
Yeah, this is what he says. He's like, I'm sure you hate the band, and I'll get to that in a minute. I'm sure you hate the band, but John Fishman is pretty incredible. That band plays 7-hour sets, and he plays a lot of notes. I played Fish songs in the band Giant.
Okay.
I played like a handful of them.
Yeah. What do you think?
I'm not a Fish fan, but I do like some of their songs. And when I played them live, when I was in Giant, not to get off on a tangent, but that band purposely, they would tell me, like, don't worry about playing what the drummer plays note for note.
Fish drummer played, okay.
Yeah, and that was like that for almost every song we played. It was kind of free form, right? Mm-hmm. So you kind of, as long as the feel is good, they weren't worried about that. We weren't a cover band, so it was kind of like just, you know, put your own spin on it.
Cool, right?
So there's some definitely cool things going on with Fish. If you like the jam band thing, I'm not really into it that much, but because I have experience in playing some of their songs and having to listen to the stuff to get to know it, I can definitely appreciate it. He has some cool stuff. But I definitely don't hate Fish. I'm not an active listener or fan. I'm probably more of a less than a casual fan, because I really don't even keep up with what they're doing, but I know that they're still relevant. People still listen to them. They still draw big crowds. They have a Dave Matthews band like cult following.
Yeah, I think it's like a weird, it's like a bizarre. I don't know.
That was one of his comments.
Yeah.
He had another one, which is Ringo of the Beatles.
So I gotta play, before you read this, I gotta play 4 Beatles tunes at Wilson's wedding in Virginia. I think it's Virginia. In June next month. So like I have. There's no practice. There's no. Just like I just gotta show up and play for like his wedding in next month in Virginia, which is cool. But like this like transfers over to like, okay, what the fuck am I doing? You know.
Have you ever played any Beatles songs before?
I don't think so.
I've covered a few in the DR5 and the cover band I was in, but if you listen to Drive My Car, the fill to come into it is kind of offbeat a little bit.
Shows up or something.
Where the fill starts, like how it comes in, it's almost like, I don't know, maybe it's just because I never really like sat there and like tried to chart it out, but it almost was like a feel thing. It was almost like it I would tap to it and I really never got the feel. It was almost like you kind of just hope that you...
You just gotta hope.
Yeah, yeah, you kind of have right? to... Yeah, you just gotta kind of feel it out. But there's some stuff with Ringo, man, that I think he's underrated as far as a drummer, because... Flashy? No, not necessarily.
Yeah.
I think he could do more than he let on. If you read a lot of the books about the Beatles and...
He, like, knew what he was doing.
Yeah, right? Dude. I think what it is, though, is, like, one of the interesting things about him is listen to the lack of use of hi-hat in some of his songs. Like, I don't know, is it You Won't See Me or something like that? Some of the stuff on the White Album, like, it's like there's a lot of and they'll throw the hi-hat in there, but it'll be like this random, you know, open hi-hat thing, like, but there's not nowhere, right? There's not a lot of, especially in the later Beatles stuff, there's not a lot of 2 and 4 drum beats where the hi-hat's just going throughout the whole thing, where so you weird. Where you could easily do that.
Yeah,
but he
and get away with it.
Yeah, right? I think that, you know, there's some things about the Beatles stuff that, you know, you listen to it and it's like, oh, this is, you know, easy stuff. But again, like, try and play it.
Yeah,
play right. it, and then you'll notice that there's some things that are not quite as natural. I would say natural as far as, you know, that is what you would think to play. But he mentioned on here. Ringo is being underrated when the Beatles changed their sound during Rubber Soul. I don't know how much I agree with changing their sound on that one, because I think they really changed their sound probably more on Revolver when they got Jeff Emmerich. But Rubber Soul is a great record in general. Ringo is a huge part of that sound. He's not fast, but he's a good songwriter. Listen to the change in his beats from Hard Day's Night to Rubber Soul. I can respect that. There's definitely some different stuff going on there. Wilson knows his drumming, so he knows what's going on there. So as a listener, you know, he's obviously got some good thoughts on that. Yes, so thanks, Wilson, for that. Yeah,
thank you.
Let's see what else we got here. So, Dave Lombardo. We didn't really talk about Slayer too much, but Mike Boyd brought up Dave Lombardo. Mm-hmm. He called him the John Bonham of thrash metal. If you speed up Zeppelin recordings and then fed Bonham speed, you get Dave Lombardo. So, I'm going to read a couple more here before we talk about that. So, William Goldsmith from... Sunny Day Real Estate. Really like his tone and style, especially on LP2, which is the pink record.
Great record, yeah.
What do we think about William Goldsmith?
So, well, interestingly enough, like today, when I was just kind of like coasting through some tunes, like I went through some Sunny Day shit, and I went through first record, A Diary. Went through LP2, and then I went through How It Feels.
What It Feels to Be Like Something on.
Or something. And I was just, like, coasting through, like, a couple tunes or whatever, and I realized, like, holy shit, man, LP2 sounds the best. I always thought it was How It Feels to Be Something On.
I always thought it was Diary.
See, I love Diary. Very raw. Very, like, just in your face. LP2 for drums. Today, May, what is it, 19th? Thought that was the shit, dude. For what it was.
I think Sunday Real Estate... What's interesting about that is, people that might not know, William Goldsmith was the drummer in Foo Fighters for a little bit before they kicked him out. Well, he actually left. They gave him the choice to stay. But,
did they?
Okay. Yeah, well, he was supposed to be on The Color and the Shape, and it didn't, you know, Dave Grohl obviously didn't like the way it was sounding, so he re-recorded all the drums, told him he'd like him to stay in the band, and Goldsmith was like, I can't do that.
I recorded everything.
I re-recorded everything. But
Okay.
Yeah. So, but you know, it's one of those things where, you know, it's kind of like, would you put Neil Peart in Nirvana?
Good call.
You know?
No.
I mean, William Goldsmith is perfect for Sunday Real Estate.
Yeah.
Probably not so perfect for Foo Fighters, I guess.
Yeah.
So, that was one thing. Dave Lombardo. So, I kind of struggled with this one because I picked up the new Dead Cross record, which is Mike Patton and Dave Lombardo, which is pretty sick.
That's a weird...
I have it.
Okay.
Let's check it out. It's pretty awesome.
That's kind of cool.
But, you know, listen to Dave Lombardo on Rain and Blood or War Ensemble or Season of the Abyss, I'm sorry. And South of Heaven, probably the three classic Slayer records that people refer to. There was really no drummer at the time doing a lot of what he was doing. Pretty sick feat, you know?
Yeah.
But the one thing about Lombardo I think is pretty special is he is one of those drummers where you pretty much know it's him when he's playing.
Yep.
What's your thoughts about Dave Lombardo?
No, Dave Lombardo, awesome. I feel like Lombardo was... kind of I'm not sure, did he choose to leave Slayer?
He's left Slayer a couple times.
I mean, I know, but
some of it over money issues and stuff.
Yeah, so I'm not sure like what happened with like Lombardo between the last record he did, which I could not pin down.
Christ Illusion, I think.
Okay. But then the one that Paul Bostoff picked up on, which was Divine Intervention.
Oh, right? Yeah. You're talking about the first time Lombardo left.
So, like, I'm not sure
what
went down there. But, like, I always liked, loved Lombardo. But I always loved Paul Bostoff. Because he did an interview in Modern Drummer. And he said, I fucking warm up with bones. Like, fake bones that I found when we were playing a show. And, no, this is serious. I found fake bones in some college that we were playing, like, for their, like, anatomy class or whatever, and that's what I warm up with, like, on stage now. He, like, took the femurs and shit, yeah. And I'm like, that's awesome.
That is weird, man.
Yeah, but that's a true. You can probably research that shit.
So one comment on here from Zeke. Danny Carey of Tool, we talked about Ticks and Leeches.
Mm-hmm.
So you said that you had some things about Tool you wanted to talk about, Danny Carey in general. What were your what were your thoughts on that?
I mean, I think like Danny Carey is a great drummer. The only thing that upsets me about Danny Carey is that I feel like he can't get away from the... how do you put it? He uses Simmons drum pads, right?
Okay.
To trigger a lot of his, like, shit. And he hasn't, like, evolved from these 80s, 90s Simmons drum pads. No,
so this is the deal?
For real. Like, I mean, he's still stuck on these till this day. Like,
I didn't even know he was using those.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. And it's like... Dude, just fucking move on, man. Like,
you don't think he's evolved at all?
That's what I'm saying.
Yeah.
I'm feeling like he's stuck in this, like, fucking rut.
Well, it doesn't help that Tool doesn't come out with an album except for, like, once every 10 years or something.
Well, so they're on, like, 17 years now or something. Like, something crazy. Like, even Maynard is, like, yelling at his band now. So, like, dude, just finish up the music so I can write songs. Like, you can research this. He's, like, really angry with his band because He's like, this is stupid now.
It's to the point where they've kind of lost my interest because it's just too...
Exactly. It's been too long.
Yeah. So that's the deal with Tool. We talked a little bit about his comment about Mike Portnoy of Dream Theater. So I told him in my comment, I never was a Dream Theater fan just because I'm not into the operatic... I'm never into the theatrical vocals, which is kind of why I never really became a big Iron Maiden fan, as much as I love songs like The Trooper and... you know, some of the classic stuff I love, like, you know, 2 Minutes to Midnight. And I'm not into that style of vocals. And I think that Dream Theater, to me, it's like, as good as Mike Portnoy is, and I know he's good, and he's in other bands like the Winery Dogs, and there's some other bands he's been in. I think he's in that new Sons of Apollo band. I've not really listened to that. But Dream Theater in general, I had a couple buddies that tried to get me to listen to them. I never could get into it.
Yeah.
So it's kind of hard for me to really say too much about it. Aaron, Barn Dollar, do you know Aaron?
Yep.
Okay, so Aaron and I were in a band together for a while. He brought up Santana. You know, Giovanni Hidalgo playing on the Conga Kings album. You know, I'm not familiar enough with that stuff. I've got a couple like jazz type things I'll bring up that I wanted to bring up as things that I dig. But yeah, I mean, unfortunately, I don't know enough about that stuff. I did see Santana live 2 years ago in Vegas, and it was one of the best concerts I've seen.
Wow.
It was at the House of Blues in Mandalay Bay, and it was so entertaining. He puts on an amazing show. Drummer and percussionist, I don't know who it was. Unfortunately, it wasn't probably with
Fertangelo, right?
What's that?
Probably Fertangelo.
I don't know.
At one
point, the drummer for, and we'll get into this, one of my favorite drummers ever is Dennis Chambers, and at one point he was their drummer.
Okay.
For some of the live shows. I know Paul was lucky enough to see them with Dennis Chambers on drums. I would love to see that.
Yeah. That'd be cool.
But so thanks, Aaron, and everybody else that submitted some comments on Facebook. Definitely want to include you guys in the next episode, which we're gonna do hopefully sometime this June. And we're going to be doing one on Zeppelin. We're going to be doing one on Jack White.
Yep.
The White Stripes, and you know, probably all the stuff he's been involved in. We talked about Gar Samuelson a little bit from Megadeth. Ringo Starr, underrated drummers. Any underrated drummers you can think of, people that you think are just pretty awesome that nobody really gives much credit or appreciation to? Like Mike White. Come on. I figured you're going to bring her up at least once, right?
I'm not.
Come on. Are you saving that for the White Stripes episode?
I love Croft.
Come on.
No, honestly, I don't know. Like, let's get back into that at a later time.
All right, think about it.
Yeah, but I don't. No, not Meg White.
So this was a fun...
I love you, Meg.
Yeah. This is a fun exercise here, you know, with drumming and stuff.
Yeah.
So overall, like when you're looking for records today that inspire you drum wise, what are the things that you're looking for?
Yeah, I'm just looking for if I put on, like, you and I, we probably not knowingly put on our engineering hat. You know, we listen for a tone. You know, like, that's probably not fair to drummers, but we listen for, like, a snare drum or a kick drum or how that impacts us. But, like, for how individually a drummer affects us, like, I would say, like, I listen for, like, just, like, creativity versus, like, really playing appropriately to the track, but at the same time, like, you know, giving us something creative where we can you know, latch on to and say, like, oh, cool.
Sweet.
You know, it doesn't have to be technical. This has to be, like, something where we can say, like, wow, interesting.
Yeah, I think I look for the same thing. I think it's I look for those wow moments at times. I look for creativity. I look for things that, you know, it would have been so easy if you wanted to talk like technically strong drummers to just pick 10 metal albums.
Yeah.
You know?
Right.
But yeah, that's not really what we were trying to do, and I think that, you know, neither of us came from that background as far as the bands we've played in. So, you know, I think the list that we came up with could be different tomorrow.
Yeah.
You know, so, you know, what we want to know is, what are some things that, you know, maybe you feel that were missed in this conversation? If there's some band or some albums or specific songs that you feel that should be brought up, you know, definitely reach out. You know, you can send an email to Jay Croft at Warm Chord Music, or go to the Warm Chord Music page on Facebook. Leave your comments. Let us know what you think. Facebook, like we said, is it's out there, but you can also go to iTunes. You know, leave us some stars. 5 stars would be preferred. You know, leave some comments.
5.5 if you can somehow.
Yeah, let us know what you think about drum wise. You know, what you're looking for in a drum performance or a song or whatever. However you want to. It's really up to you. This is all subjective stuff.
That's what's cool about it. Like Jay and I, we can talk whatever type of, you know, lingo you need. We chose on this one to talk very subjective, right? So we just went like whatever, you know, like we were feeling at the time, but, you know, we can get as technical as you want with it, I suppose.
Cool. Well, we're gonna go ahead and end it here. Yep. But
and I gotta pee.
Yeah. So do I. It sounds like a good time to stop.
Yeah.
So, all right. Well, thanks, Ryan, for taking some time. We're definitely going to continue doing these. And, you know, definitely let us know what your thoughts are about this episode and future episodes that you want to hear, topics you want us to tackle. We definitely want to hear from you. So, all right. Cool. Thanks. All right.
Peace. Out. And
I think I have to do that.